Good morning, everyone. Happy spring and welcome to our weekly COVID media update. I am Kerri Schuette, the Public Information Officer for the Shasta County Health and Human Services Agency. We'll start with the numbers, the statistics from March 19th and 20th, and we have a total of 11,179 confirmed cases, including 26 from Friday and 7 from Saturday. And this is not the most current report. So we're going to go find that report. Hold on one quick second. Sorry about that. Everybody take a deep cleansing breath. Shoot, I'm kind of new here. Okay.
We're paid by the hour.
That's right. Sorry. For March 21st and 22nd, from yesterday's report, we have 11,199 cases, including 4 from Sunday and 16 from Monday. We have 5 people hospitalized in Shasta County and 0 in the intensive care unit for the first time since October 17th, which was a nice breath of fresh air to see. I'm sure our hospital folks would agree with that. Our available regional ICU capacity is at 29.1%. We've done a total of 173,043 tests, and we have 107 active cases, almost 11,000 people who have been released from isolation to date. And we also had the milestone yesterday of marking, reporting our 200th death from COVID-19 in Shasta County, which is a sobering and sad statistic. I wanted to let everyone know just right off the jump that we have plenty of vaccine appointments available right now for first dose clinics this week, Pfizer and Moderna both. If you go to ShastaReady.org and click on vaccinations, it's a very simple process to sign up. You click a button, you pick your time. It's very easy. So we encourage you, if you fall into one of the categories that can be vaccinated now, that's that population is quite large now and growing. So please double check to see if you qualify. And if you're interested in vaccine, please sign up for one of those clinics. With us today, we have Robin Schurig, the Director of the Public Health Branch of the Shasta County Health and Human Services Agency. Dr. Karen Ramstrom is our Health Officer. Dean Germano is from Shasta Community Health Center. Robert Folden from Mercy Medical Center, Reading. Mark Mitchelson from Shasta Regional Medical Center. And Glenn Hayward from the Reading Rancheria Health Center. Thank you all for being here. Robin, would you like to start us off this morning?
Yes, thank you. Good morning. So I have the latest tier assignment data to share with you that was announced yesterday, and I'll also share a brief update that I shared with the Board of Supervisors yesterday on some things that the state is talking about with regard to allowable activities going forward. So I'll start with the tier assignment data. We continue to be in the red tier. Our case rate decreased again from 5 daily cases per 100,000 population last week to 4.5 this week. And our test positivity also decreased from 2% last week to 1.8% this week. That test positivity measure actually falls within the yellow tier, but with our equity metric at 2.1%, which is in the orange tier, we are not eligible for a move out of the red just yet, but we are headed in the right direction. Again, our case rate would need to decrease to less than 4, or our test positivity would need to stay less than 2%, and the equity metric would need to decrease to less than 2%. For us to qualify for a move to the orange. And we would need to meet that criteria for 2 weeks in a row before we would move. There are currently only 8 counties in the purple tier, and there are now 39 in the red tier, 9 in the orange, and 2 in the yellow. Case rates, test positivity, and hospitalizations are down throughout the state. And because of that, combined with the fact that more and more people are getting vaccinated, the California Department of Public Health is working on some new guidance for outdoor seated live performances and events, sleepaway camps, graduations, and others. And they've also started talking about a green phase. They explained that this would not be another tier in the tier system, but rather what comes next after the tier system is no longer needed. They didn't give a specific time frame or triggers for when that would come into play or what exactly it would look like, but we will keep you posted as we learn more about that. And that's all I have for today. I know that Dr. Ramstrom also has an update, including that, as Kerri mentioned, there are many available vaccine appointments for those who are eligible. So I will let Karen tell you more about that.
Yeah, thank you, Robin. Good morning, everybody. So yes, as Kerri and Robin said, we do have a lot of vaccine appointments available in the community now. And Shasta Ready has been reorganized a bit on the vaccine page to make it really easy to find locations you can go to get vaccinated. And I thought I would just recap the groups and to clarify some confusion that might be limiting people from feeling like it's their turn to go get vaccinated. And so I thought I would just review that real quickly. So healthcare personnel are still being vaccinated, people 65 and older, people who work in certain sectors, including education and childcare, emergency services, and food and agriculture. And those sectors are open to all ages that are able to get vaccinated, people 16 and over. And so please, even if you're in, if you work in a restaurant or you work in a grocery store and you're under that age 65, it still qualifies you. So all ages for those sectors. In addition, all ages, people who have underlying health conditions, and your doctor says it would be really great for you to get vaccinated because I feel that you're at high risk. We highly encourage you to go ahead and get vaccinated. People who work or live in a congregate setting, so our detention facilities, our homeless shelter and behavioral health facilities are all eligible for vaccination now. Janitors are eligible for vaccination, as are public transit and airport and commercial airline workers as they come into contact with the public quite a lot. So we encourage you to go to Shasta Ready, and you can see this beautiful graphic that will show you who's eligible. And it lists all those details that I just spoke about, and also lists the clinics you can click on to look for appointments to get vaccinated. And just to really remind people why this is so important right now, our numbers are in a really good place. Our hospitals are not experiencing the high level of numbers right now, which is wonderful. but we are still concerned about these variant strains that are more infectious and that may not be as amenable to vaccination or treatment that are available. And so we're kind of up against a little bit of a time crunch. We want to get people vaccinated as quickly as possible to avoid having increased transmission as these variant strains increase in our community. We know outbreaks are happening in other parts of the state. We are sending specimens to the state for genotyping. We have identified one variant strain in our community, and that typing has just started in the last month or so. So we're sending some samples. So we do want to just provide that caution to everybody and encourage you to get vaccinated if you're interested, and we hope that you are. And we have revamped Shasta Ready, so hopefully it's easier to find locations to go and seek a vaccination clinic. Happy to address any questions.
All right, thank you, Dr. Ramstrom. Do any of our healthcare partners have anything we'd like to share this morning?
Yeah, so for Shasta Regional, we've had a great turnout with the community for our injection clinics. But we are doing it a little bit differently in the month of April. We are shutting down the phone line that people would typically have called in to get appointments for. And we're directing everybody to ShastaRegional.com. And on the homepage, there's a gold banner at the very top. It says vaccine clinic. And it goes through the My Turn enrollment process for the state. And you can see where you have available vaccines, dates, times, and all that fun stuff. So really trying to go more electronic than the phone numbers at this time. So if anybody wants the injections and fit into the criteria that Dr. Ramstrom has said, that's a great resource too.
And then just succinctly, I'll go over a few things. So yes, Dr. Ramstrom, it's nice to kind of have the hospitals back to a better sense of normalcy. We actually took down some of the physical barriers that we had in place while we had COVID patients here in the hospital. So it's kind of nice to see the hospital opened up a little more. So with that, we talked about visitation. We're now at a point where we're allowing at least one visitor for folks who are here in the hospital. We're excited that our volunteers are starting to come back. So we have, again, a slightly larger volunteer task force that's here on site, and we've opened up our gift shop on Tuesdays and Thursdays, again, just in an effort to sort of slowly reintroduce folks as we're comfortable and they're comfortable returning. And then as you come through the front entrance, people are going to see some new technology that our staff are using for screening. So we did adopt the CARE AI model. So we have these two devices that sort of look like an iPad, and our staff are using those for their daily screening and logging into the hospital. And then lastly, again, I just want to share my gratitude to the county and for the assistance with the vaccination clinics. So we think we're going to be back on track starting this Friday to be able to vaccinate upwards of 3,000 people almost every Friday. It won't quite be every Friday, but we're excited. So that model has worked well. And I'll tell you, there's not a person who volunteers or is working out there that doesn't leave at the end of the day with their heart full. So it's the stories that we hear from people, just being around people that we haven't seen for a long time, and then providing a service to the community. It's been good for the soul.
All right. Thank you, Robert. Dean or Glenn?
Well, I'll just add that we are also sort of retweaking our processes here a little bit. We've had a respiratory assessment center that will be converted more into an immunization piece rather than just testing. And we are reconfiguring, like I said, and we hope by mid-April we will be able to ramp up to more of a, maybe as much as 500 patients a day, really focusing on our own patient population to the extent they haven't already been immunized. And so I think we're all feeling better about the availability of vaccine. We'll, like a lot of our health center colleagues, we'll be getting direct federal allocation of vaccines in addition to whatever comes from the state. So the whole pipeline of vaccines are starting to become more abundant, and which will open things up, I think, across the board. So really excited to be able to add that piece to what we can give.
All right, thanks, Dean. Anything else from anyone before we get started? I did forget that I promised to share that if most of our appointments are through an online system, and we know that some people don't have access to the internet. So if that is you or someone that that you know and that you might be wanting to help, you can have them call our call center at 530-245-7890. They can provide you with any help that you might need in signing up for vaccination. Okay, I think we are ready for media questions.
Well, I've got a question for Robin. Robin, you mentioned CDPH working on outdoor events. I've got grandparents and other people saying, I can't go watch my grandson's football games and that sort of thing. We've got the River Bowl coming up on Friday. Can you be any more specific about what might be in the pipeline?
So they're working on guidance for outdoor events, and it will include some guidance around spectators. For example, there's going to need to be reserved seating, is my understanding. That guidance hasn't been released yet, so I don't know for sure what the specifics will look like, but that's one thing that they have mentioned. And they have said that at that time, when that guidance is released, which should be any day now, they will revise the youth sports guidance to be in alignment with that. So I think the spectator restrictions that exist right now for youth sports are going to be opened up some. I just don't have any specifics on what that's going to look like.
Is there a timeline on that at all?
So they've said that the guidance for the live performances and events will go into effect April 1st. We're hoping that they will release it sooner than April 1st, but it won't be effective until April 1st. And I think we were sort of expecting it to come out last week, and it did not. So any minute now, I'm expecting it to come out, but it won't go into effect until April 1st.
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Anna here. This one is for Robin. You know, we've been talking about it for a while, but how's that orange outlook looking for us right now? I mean, our numbers are going down. We have some of our categories in the orange and yellow. So what is it going to take for us to get to the orange officially?
Yeah, so we're really close to being able to be eligible for the orange based on that equity metric. It's just a tenth of a percentage higher than it needs to be in order to qualify us. And so if that decreases again next week, and it has continued to decrease over the last several weeks, so we do expect that to continue, then that will put us in that eligible place to move to the orange, but we would need to be there for 2 weeks. So it wouldn't be until the following week at the soonest that we'd be able to move.
And then, thank you, Robin. Also, you know, big milestone yesterday, no ICU cases. I just wanted to ask, you know, for anyone on this call, is this kind of promising for the county? I mean, this is kind of a big deal.
Yeah, I agree. It is a big deal. It's wonderful news. And I think it's worth celebrating. And but we also need to not let our guard down. We're not out of the woods yet. This is still, this virus is still transmitting in other parts of the state and the nation. And we're still vulnerable to that because we don't have enough immunity in our community from past infection or from vaccination. It's unclear with these new variants whether past infection will be fully protective against the future exposure. You know, these new strains are more infectious. They can transmit to more people. And so I think right now is our time to enjoy having a little bit more liberties with our activities, but at the same time, taking the time to get vaccinated so that we can be prepared should our community be exposed to these new variants, and really increasing our vaccination rates over the next couple of months as we move into the fall when there is concern about being indoors and potentially more transmission with these new variants. So it's great news and it's opportunity to celebrate, but also not be overly, we need to be cautious still.
Thank you, Dr. Ramstrom. And I just wanted to follow up on something. You mentioned a strain being identified here in Shasta County. Do you know what strain that was and when was it identified?
Yeah, we started sending a sample of our positive specimens to the state about a month ago. And the state is sampling statewide now. So this strain that was identified, it was from about a month ago, was a B117 variant. That's the one that was caused so much issues in the UK. It's more transmissible, about 50% more transmissible, is thought to be associated with higher risk of illness and death. And we're continuing, we're in a process now where we're sending samples on a weekly basis to the state for typing, and they're really ramping up their capacity to do more testing, whole genome sequencing of these specimens and faster turnaround. So this was just the first, it was yesterday afternoon, so we don't have a lot of additional information.
At this time, is there any risk of that strain, you know, for community transmission of that one?
Absolutely. There definitely is risk of that, which is why we're really encouraging vaccination and that people continue as you're out and exposed to people not part of your household, that you continue to mask and physically distance for that very reason. We're a mobile population, and that's partly why there's the travel advisory right now, but we recognize people travel for work and other reasons. And so it's possible to go to a different community and get exposed and bring it home to Reading. And so we really want people to continue to be careful.
And so at this time, we don't know how this strain came into our community, correct?
Yeah, I don't have a lot of additional information, Anna, at this point. But like I said, you know, it's not unexpected, just based on, you know, our population moves about quite a lot for a variety of different reasons. And so it's anticipated it will come here. And this is the first case identified.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Yes, hi, this is Daisy with Channel 7. I'm not sure if you guys can hear me all right.
Yes, go ahead, Daisy.
Perfect, sorry about that. So I understand that Shasta County is going to be working on transitioning with Blue Shield as a vaccine administrator. Can you guys kind of tell me a little bit more about that and what that will look like here in Shasta County and what that means to you?
Sure. I think you broke up a little bit, but I think you're asking about Blue Shield as a third party administrator. So they've been contracted by the state to develop a network of vaccine providers statewide. And so we have entered into an agreement with them at the county. And we know many of our community providers are also doing that or have done that. And the intention of that is to establish a working relationship with Blue Shield in terms of weekly allocations and how we're reporting our doses administered and how we're reporting our inventory and how we're scheduling those appointments in a more uniform manner. And so that's really just getting implemented starting this week in terms of the way that we're allocating to our providers, and it's going to continue to evolve over the next couple of weeks. And as Mark mentioned, I'm using that My Turn platform that you'll also see at Shasta Ready, is that you're going to see more of that. It's a scheduling platform to look for clinic appointments.
Thank you very much for that. And then I don't know if this would be maybe a question that fit for Mark, as he was the one that kind of started talking a little bit more about the My Turn. So again, what for those people who are, this is the first time you've been hearing what My Turn is, can you explain a little bit about that and what exactly is going to be on that My Turn website and how the county is going to be transitioning, hopefully, to My Turn?
Sure. It's really just an appointment scheduling, a self-scheduling type of database where you put in what location you live in, and it kind of tells you based on zip codes where the different appointment schedules are, where it's available, what times are available. And I know some places have begun doing this in other parts of the state, and these appointments do come up and get filled fairly quickly. So it is something that if you're interested in getting enrolled and getting the shot, you do want to be as quick to enroll as you can, because we want to get you the fastest appointment time. So it is definitely a work in process. I know there's been a couple bugs here and there, but it really is going to uniformly get everybody onto a cleaner schedule. So, we want to maximize the amount of vaccine we have and don't waste any. So I think this will help us maximize the potential.
I wanted to add to Daisy that is how public health is making appointments right now for our clinics. And so if you go to My Turn and type in your information, you'll see our information. And then if you scroll down, there are other clinics that are in Shasta County that are already right now today using the My Turn system.
Perfect. So as of right now, just to reiterate, you guys are using completely the My Turn website.
That's correct. We're using other things too for various clinics, but yes, we are using the My Turn system.
And at Shasta Community, we're going to do, when we start really ramping up, we'll be using the My Turn system as well for appointments.
Thank you all so much. And Kerri, is there a specific time frame that people can anticipate for Shasta County completely going to My Turn and not using anything else? Is there a timeline for that?
I actually don't know what that process involves. Robin probably knows better than I do about what technical requirements have to be in place for someone to shift over to the My Turn system.
Yeah, so we still have some providers who receive their vaccine directly from the federal government, and so they have not been asked necessarily to enter into an agreement with Blue Shield or to switch over to the My Turn platform. So there still will continue to be some vaccine providers who don't use My Turn. And then for each of the providers who are going to be transitioning to that, they're on, their own timeframes based on, like you said, Kerri, what technology they have in place and what other scheduling system they might be using now that they need to transition from.
Daisy, I'd encourage you to go to my turn and just give it, just pretend like you were going to set yourself up for a vaccine clinic. You can see that exactly how it looks. You click on it, you put in your information, and it just pops right up the available appointment times. It's really easy to use.
Perfect. I will definitely do that. Thank you guys so much. And then just one super last minute question. Is there a reason as to why we are moving to partnering up with Blue Shield specifically?
Why we're partnering with Blue Shield? So this is how the state of California is establishing their provider vaccine network statewide, and local health jurisdictions, local health departments work routinely with the California Department of Public Health for vaccine distribution. And so it's sort of a streamlined, organized system statewide that the state is establishing through this partnership with Blue Shield.
Great, thank you guys so much.
Any other media questions?
If everybody else is done, okay, I'm a knucklehead. I'm not sure that the answer recorded when I asked Robin about the outdoor CDPH thing. So I'd like to ask her that again. If everybody else is done, I wanted to wait until the end.
Sure, of course.
So if that's the case, Robin, could you tell me again, please? You know, what the CDPH is working on as far as outdoor events and when that might happen.
Yeah, so the state is working on guidance for outdoor seated live performances and events. So seated meaning that there's going to be reserved seating that is required so that you can maintain capacity limitations. It will vary by tier, and we don't have a whole lot of specifics because the guidance has not come out yet, but we expect it to be released any day now, and it will go into effect on April 1st. They've also said that when they release that, they are going to make some revisions to the youth sports guidance so that the spectator restrictions will be more in line with those outdoor seated live events and performances.
Thank you. I think that was even better than the first time. I appreciate your patience.
Second time is always the charm. Any other media questions?
Oh, sorry. I just wanted to follow up on one more thing. Dr. Ramstrom, any update on that, on our testing sites turning into vaccine sites?
No, sorry, I don't have an update. We're hoping to turn one of our testing sites into a vaccine clinic, as we've shared before. And I don't know the exact timeline on that, but we're continuing to follow up every week. And we'll let you know when that's in place.
Perfect. Thank you.
All right. Any other media questions? I've got a handful of questions from the public, and I will try and whiz through these. At what age can someone be tested for COVID with a PCR test? The CDC does not list a minimum age for PCR testing. As you know, if you've been tested, it's a simple swab just of the inside of the nose. How do you provide informed consent for vaccine at the Hope Van and strike teams, and how is patient safety ensured? These patients receive the same information as anyone who attends a vaccination clinic, and the strike team does include nurses who can respond to a medical emergency should one arise. Dean, did you have anything to add to that as the Hope Van guy?
No, we use the same process, same provision of written information, and staff are there to help if there's some issue that needs clarification. And we do witness the period after the vaccine is administered, like everywhere else.
Sure. Thank you very much. This one is for Glenn Hayward. How does Redding Rancheria Tribal Health provide informed consent to patients?
Whenever one of our patients registers online for our vaccine clinics, they receive a confirmation email, like for this weekend for the MassComp vaccine. They get a confirmation email with all the information regarding the vaccine that we're given that provides everything they need to know about that vaccine. And then at the day of our mass vaccination clinic, we probably have 8 to 10 physicians that are here walking around, answering questions that are available to the patients if they need them.
Excellent. Thank you very much. For Dr. Ramstrom, will HHSA and community partners address the increase in VAERS death reports?
So there are several post-trial monitoring systems that are in place in the United States to identify rare events that are not during the clinical trials. So that includes VAERS, as we've talked about before, the VSafe app, the vaccine safety data link that looks across health systems for vaccinated versus unvaccinated individuals nationwide. And none of those surveillance systems have resulted in updates to the list of adverse effects attributed to the COVID-19 vaccines. As you've shared before, the most severe adverse effect of which we've spoken about is anaphylaxis, which occurs at a rate of about 2.5 to 4.7 per million. So no additional updates since then.
Great, thank you very much. Can wearing masks cause bacterial pneumonia?
I would say no.
Okay. Let's see, we've got one, two. Okay, we've got time for these. Could you please provide the statute that Health and Human Services is operating under that allows public health employees to restrict business operations, determine who is essential and non-essential, quarantine people, require masks, deny sick or dying family members from visits in their final days, and so on? That is probably a Robin Schurig question.
Yeah, give me just a second.
I can address that if you like, Robin. So, you know, we've shared all along that we have been working really closely with our community members and businesses and others to provide education and safety information in response to the pandemic. And the guidance regarding businesses, face coverings, quarantine, healthcare facilities, all of that is developed and produced by the California Department of Public Health and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. There are health and safety codes that provide the health officer to have authority to implement measures to prevent the spread of communicable diseases, including isolation and quarantine. We could provide those specific codes in writing if that would be helpful. I didn't note them down today, but there are several that have parameters in place for isolation and quarantine.
Great, thank you. The death rate shown in the daily report was approximately 1 to 2 per week during the later half of 2020, but I noticed a spike around mid-December that has continued to the present, as many as several a day. Please explain. And as the keeper of the data, I would love to answer that question. We did have a large spike in cases starting at Halloween and continuing through the holidays. And every time we have a spike in cases, we can expect to see a spike in hospitalizations and then unfortunately a spike in deaths. So that is what you are seeing. And then the last question is, I've been following the ICU capacity numbers closely since they began being used as a metric. And I noticed recently when there were several in the ICU, it hovered around 32%, but when we dropped to one patient in the ICU, the capacity dropped to 29%. And now it's down to 0 patients and the percent of available ICU capacity is down in the mid-20s. Could you please explain this? And the answer to that is that the regional ICU capacity reflects capacity in all of the intensive care units in the 11 county Northern California region. So it's not just impacted by the patients in the hospitals that we have in Shasta County. It's by 11 different counties, all of whom have different numbers of people in their ICUs. So that is why. All right, that's all I've got. Does anybody have any other questions before we adjourn for the day? Hearing none, thank you all very much. Stay safe and healthy, and we will see you all again next week. Have a great day.
Thank you.